There is only one way to approach an understanding of Puck. You have to do the work.
You have to do the work.
There is a method in the madness. Matter is compressed down to an infinitely tiny point. This is, in fact, the genesis. We can reduce the world to a single pixel. Puck is the nothing from which all matter and energy emanated from. Isn't that poetic?
Welcome back. If you feel like you've fallen down a giant rabbit hole, trust me, I understand. I spent a week in this crazy world that is the Packverse, and I've learned a lot. And what I'm discovering is that there is so much that I still don't know and won't ever know, and it's all there on Pack's Twitter account. So if you want to bypass all of this and really dig in, that's where you go. Now, over the last 2 years or so, Pack has been first and foremost a crypto artist. And during that time, we've witnessed an acceleration of ideas and aesthetics in lockstep with the explosion of the broader crypto art space. And this has seen Puck move from a shop window style artist, exquisitely displayed in a crystal cabinet, to one that said, fuck it, bought the entire high street and turned it into a giant amusement park. One that was constructed around ideas and engineering that can only exist on blockchain. To begin with, the form was one of ones. Many, but not all, employing the same Cassini-inspired monochrome palette that we saw in the first film. Some were animated, some interactive, and often playful. But there's color as well in some absolute standouts, such as Reboot Ginevra, based on the Ginevra da Benci by Leonardo da Vinci. But as we can now see, the one of one model is just legacy art auction mechanics ported into blockchain. It's not a reinvention, and it's clear Puck was interested in doing far more than just sell their work. And a clue can be found in an interview Puck gave to Nick Tamino back in September 2020.
I had a chance to meet Bitcoin in its very early days thanks to my social circles, so crypto-related scenes were always in my interest zone. However, crypto art in particular is an era I've met just recently through social media. After some reading, I've realized it may be a chance to leave permanent marks on the future's history. That idea was the charm. For some of us, it's about writing history. You can't expect someone to be loud about a history book unless you give them the page they deserve.
The first big collection that was launched was Terminus, which launched on Maker's Place. And there are clear echoes here of the node, but all the elements are bleached to a ghostly white. Now, a terminus is the final destination on a railway, but it's also the name of the planet where Harry Seldon's followers settle to create an encyclopedia of all human knowledge in Asimov's Foundation series. The planet is chosen because it's an outlier, keeping the Foundation out of sight of the Empire, free to get on with its mission. And it's a funny coincidence that the TV series is now airing on Apple TV, because on Terminus sits a mystical, impenetrable object, which looks like this.
It became known as the Vault, and over the decades, countless myths grew up around it.
But maybe we shouldn't read too much into that. So there were more collections as Puck shifted to Nifty Gateway with collections like Narcissus and X, where the work was segmented into tiers of increasing scarcity. But it's really with the title where the now increasingly celebrated Puck, the provocateur, started to really mess with his collectors. This was 9 identical pieces whose only difference was their title. Now, an artwork's title is often an afterthought, tacked on because, you know, well, a piece got to have a title. But here, Puck makes it the centerpiece. And you can imagine the conversation. These NFT buyers are total idiots. They'll buy whatever you tell them to buy. If we tell them it's expensive, they'll pay whatever we ask them. Puck understood that the market was irrational, it was dumb, and it was full of unsophisticated idiots. In the MetaProfit blog, Park actually writes, creating content can be a painful process, so how about finding the content, stripping it away from its context, and reusing it? Now, I personally can appreciate the pain of having to create a collection with tiers of value, deliberately putting out supposedly less good work to satisfy a marketing hook where the cheaper ones are slightly shitter because there's more of them. Honestly, it's totally fucking stupid. And the thing is, we all play the long as well. One of one is the best. Edition of 50, bad.
This is the first of four programs in which I want to question some of the assumptions usually made about the tradition of European painting.
This is a book. It's John Berger's now legendary art criticism tome, Ways of Seeing. Now, we all think we're like well cutting edge in this era of massive technological enlightenment, but trust me when I tell you the radicals of the previous century were streets ahead of us in almost every single way. So it's fun to rewatch Berger talking about the power of context to shape our sense of value.
As well as by the movements of the camera, paintings are modified and changed by the sounds you hear when looking at them. Here is a landscape, a cornfield with birds flying out of it. Look at it for a moment in silence. Now, supposing I say whilst you look at it, this is the last picture Van Gogh painted before he killed himself.
So here's the thing. Context is a story we wrap around art to give it meaning. Now, a title might only be this tiny little unit of narrative, but it's still powerful enough to generate major sales. If you pack, anyway. Crypto native. That's the important part here. One of the critiques of the collection was in fact that the NFT only contained metadata, not the actual image file itself. All of the NFTs linked to the same IPFS file. So who actually owned what, or to what extent? How crypto native is that? All the pieces sold, apart from the unsold, which remained unsold. Understandably so, given the pieces $1 million price tag, which was ludicrously high at the time, so obviously no one was going to buy it. It was clear Puck fully understood his audience. But I do wonder if it would have remained unsold in today's market. Now, this really marked the beginning of Puck's journey from marketplace show pony to architect in chief of the entire experience. And the most important collection in that whole process is undoubtedly the fungible. This was the beginning of Puck's relationship with Sotheby's, one which had begun, appropriately enough, on Twitter when Puck called out auction houses offering to gift them something. Sotheby's responded, "We are intrigued." And what a sale it was. A maelstrom of crypto-native head-mangling that alternatively pissed off people and entertained them at the same time. Everyone in the crypto art scene kind of lost their minds over this. Over the course of the exhibition, Puck had designed several mechanisms for people to interact with, and one of these was a cryptographic message left in one of his tweets. Upon solving the message, you would receive one of four pieces from the Equilibrium, specifically the cryptographer. The puzzle itself required the use of a spectrogram to analyze the audio of the clip posted on Twitter. This then produced a QR code which gave the user an alphanumeric code, 3DKVBS5. This was then paired with a visual problem which, once solved, would produce a bit.ly link. Now the audience was engaged with the work before the main event had even started. The cryptographer was basically given away for free, which kind of removed any socio-economic barriers. But then there were three more pieces within the Equilibrium. The Hunter, which was given out for the most open editions bought. The Influencer, which was eventually given to Demi Lovato. And the Influencer was basically awarded to the person with the largest social media following who took part. And finally, the Oracle was given to the person with the closest guess to the final closing price of the auction. Who does that? Well, I'll tell you who does that. Puck does that. And this created a viral feedback loop where more users were pulled in via organic marketing, significantly amplifying social activity around the sale. And Puck was right in the thick of it all, cajoling, coaxing, whipping his audience into a frenzy. Remember this, Puck is in possession of a highly sophisticated viral marketing machine. Remember those ripple maps? We have never seen an artist that was so in tune with what was happening on social media. The main event was an open edition of cubes, which are kind of reminiscent of Sol Lewitt's geometric sculptures. Here, users could buy X amount of cubes for $500 each. But if they bought five, then they would receive a piece entitled Five Cubes instead of Five Single Cubes. Traditionally, if too many editions of a piece are created, then the piece itself tends to have a weak secondary market. Fungible is an idea that's traditionally associated with currency. So here we have the idea that a $5 bill is fungible with five single dollars. So theoretically, a five cubes NFT should be fungible with five single cubes. Do you follow me? But when I looked on OpenSea, a single cube could be purchased for 5.2 ETH, but a five cube was on sale for 11 ETH. Make of that what you will. Now, there were two other very special pieces in the collection. The Switch, which is an NFT developed to change form at a specific point of time in the future, only known by Puck. The evolution is determined and rendered immutable by smart contracts or self-executing code on the Ethereum blockchain. This piece sold, drumroll, for $1,444,444. But to date, the piece hasn't changed at all. And that leaves the final piece, the Pixel. And this was the one that really set the world of NFTs on fire. A single gray pixel, perfectly balanced between black and white. And it sold for $1,355,555 to E.T. Young. Was this the ultimate act of NFT insanity? Or was there something else, something more profound going on here? Opinions were divided.
When the Pixel dropped, I absolutely loved it. I thought it was brilliant, genius. Pac is so unique and divides opinions more than any other artist in the space, 100%. And that's just one of the reasons why I'm such a big fan. The Pixel dropped and I was already there with a box of popcorn, waiting anxiously for the comments to come flying in fast and furious, and I was not disappointed. I loved it. I loved every minute of it.
But what about the buyer himself, E.T. Young? Why did he feel moved to commit so hard to this single, solitary pixel?
Pac has been communicating the importance of the T in NFT for some time now, pushing the community to understand the capability of this new medium beyond just the JPEG. The Fungible is a collection that turns the idea of something non-fungible on its head by allowing collectors to trade their NFTs into something fungible, $ASH. Pac is consistently at the forefront of demonstrating what is possible with this medium. Pac is the most innovative crypto-native creator today. Always one, or many, steps ahead. It can be hard to see it at first glance, but that's what innovation looks like. It's usually not immediately well understood. We live in a world of immediate gratification. Collecting pack works are more akin to gradually than suddenly. It's like believing in the internet when others think it's nothing more than a glorified fax machine. How do I feel about owning possibly the most important work by the most important crypto native creator today? Pretty good, but ask me tomorrow.
The fact is, if you or I put out the Pixel, nobody would buy it, nobody would care. You have to earn the right to do something as radical as that. And for me, the Pixel is the single most important piece Puck has created to date. It represents the final curtain of the second phase of their artistic career. The thing is, this wasn't the first time Puck had released a single pixel piece. First, there was Alpha, a completely transparent pixel. And if you didn't know, in art and design, alpha channels represent transparency via a hidden grayscale channel. White is transparent, black is fully visible. Very Puck. And Puck followed up Alpha with another one, which was this time a solitary red pixel. And encoded into the pixel was a message, which read, "This red pixel is all yours. You paid the price." So the pixel was actually Puck's third single pixel statement. But what was the statement? What was it created to do? Well, let me see if I can explain. Shortly after the fungible, Puck announced burn.art, a platform for burning, or sacrificing, if you like, NFTs for a brand new token called Ash. Now, the thing is, this is a very crypto style mechanism. Burning tokens is usually a pretty flimsy way of pumping your price in crypto, but here, Puck is encouraging his collectors to think rationally about the value of the piece they own. Ash can be mined by burning NFTs, which brings a kind of dynamic balance to scarcity. So for every NFT you burn, you make the rest rarer, favoring their collectors. And the utility of Ash expands the Packverse to create its own internal currency with all the economic benefits and pitfalls that come with it. But it also forces collectors to interrogate their own motivations for owning the works. There's a big change at work here. Puck is no longer the artist on a pedestal to be collected and admired. Now the collectors are being asked to pitch in and do the work. The art itself is interactive, playing out across social media and the blockchain. By doing this, Puck is doing something profound. He's giving the art a timeline. And it's what we tried to do with the rug pull, creating a piece that would change daily and evoke an emotional response. This is storytelling. Now, the thing is, when communities can seed information near instantaneously, when everything is auditable on chain, keeping the mystery, staying ahead of your audience, is a trick that very, very, very few can pull off. But here, Puck is a master. Any student of screenwriting will innately understand the importance of choices to character development. True character is revealed in the choices they take under pressure. But the thing is, not all choices are created equal. A choice between good and evil, well, that isn't much of a choice at all. It's easy. Screenwriters understand that the most powerful choice of all is the dilemma. The greater of two goods or the lesser of two evils. Burn the art, keep the art. That is a dilemma. And through that decision, the collector learns about themselves. This dynamic is going to be amplified even further with Lost Poets, but we'll come back to that. There is so much more going on here, and it's not just the echoes with Ragnarok or Picasso's famous quote that every act of creation is first an act of destruction. On September the 15th, 2017, the 20-year-old Cassini mission ended in a death dive into Saturn's upper atmosphere, collecting data until the spacecraft itself broke apart into millions of tiny fragments and became part of the planet it set out to explore.
System Space CS1, we just had transitioned to high rate mode, and we are in the atmosphere.
We have lots of signal and extra bandwidth here,
event. Project manager, flight director.
Go ahead.
Okay, we call loss of signal at 115546.
Project manager on FSO Quart. Maybe a trickle of telemetry left, but just heard the signal from the spacecraft is gone, and within the next 45 seconds, so will be the spacecraft. I hope you're all as deeply proud of this amazing accomplishment. Congratulations to you all. This has been an incredible mission, an incredible spacecraft, and you're all an incredible team. I'm going to call this the end of mission. Project manager, off the net.
It's a breathtaking image and a fitting finale for what was also an absolutely amazing mission. Hold on to that image. So when we talk about a message, well, how pack that there is actually a message encoded into the pixel itself. I am the medium. Now, this is a clear reference to Marshall McLuhan, the Howard Stark-looking communication theorist who coined the term, the medium is the message.
The medium is not something neutral. It does something to people. It takes hold of them, it roughs them up, it massages them, it bumps them around, and as it were, chiropractically. And the general roughing up that any society gets from a medium, especially a new medium, is what is intended to be indicated in that title.
There is nothing more neutral than perfect gray, and yet it is the medium. It's clear that from the title onwards, Puck was actively engaged in shaking his audience up, challenging their crypto-native biases and tendencies towards FOMO and groupthink. And it brings us very, very neatly to the significance of the pixel, why it is such a crucial inflection point for Puck, because here, finally, we get to see the final grand design implied by that quote in the node 10 years ago.
A singularity in physics, the word really refers to any region of space and time where the conditions are so extreme that our mathematics breaks down and prevents us from gaining, at least as of today, a complete analytic understanding of what's going on. So the two primary examples are the center of a black hole, where the powerful gravitational pull warps space and time so dramatically that even Einstein's mathematics breaks down at the center of a black hole, and similarly at the Big Bang. The entire universe, imagine that being crushed to an infinitesimal speck. The conditions are so extreme that, again, Einstein's math can't cope, and we label our inability to understand what's going on with this fancy word, singularity.
So here's the fun thing about the pixel. The pixel is a singularity. It's the smallest, most compressed unit of NFT space possible. All of Puck's ideas reduced to the densest form imaginable. All of our FOMO, NFT idiocy, oversized sales headlines, Discord chats, failed transactions, and accidental scams rendered into one simple, perfect gray square. But it is very, very important that we not see this as the end. Far from it. This reduction of everything to its purest, simplest form is a purge. It's like the burn. It's creating something new from destruction. It is a new beginning, because this is a singularity that precedes a big bang. And from this point onwards, everything will explode outwards into a brave new era of Puck, an era of color, chaos, and collaboration. Coming up in part three, we will travel through the wormhole to understand the significance of the lost poets, why Narcissus is the collection with the most to tell us about the artist. And at long last, we will bring you the definitive answer to the burning question, who is Puck? You won't want to miss it.